This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. And I passed off to our lay assistant, is Terry Blackman today, and he's going to start us off.
What a bunch of smiley people. Good morning, everyone. Lovely to see you. And I can assure you, you're going to be a lot cooler than we are here at the front, because the sun's going to move around and we're going to get nice red heads. Well, I'm going to get a nice red head. So again, you are very welcome. Lovely to have you with us. And we will have our first hymn, which is in your white service booklets, the one that says Summer Hymns. And it's booklet, it's number 3, and it's How Great Is Our God.
Please stand.
Sit. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
We say together the prayer of preparation. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ said, "The first commandment is this, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. And the second is this, love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets." Amen. Amen. Lord, have mercy. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. Together, Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we have sinned against you and against our neighbor in thought and word and deed, through negligence, through weakness, through our own deliberate fault. We are truly sorry and repent of all our sins for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, who died for us. Forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may serve you in newness of life to the glory of your name. Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen. Will you please stand now for the Gloria?
Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth. Lord God, heavenly King, Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit. In the glory of God the Father.
And the collect for today. Almighty and merciful God, it is only by your grace that your faithful people offer you true and laudable service. Grant that we may run without stumbling to obtain your heavenly promises, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. And we'll have our first reading from Jane.
The psalm for today is Psalm 78, verses 1 to 26, which can be found on page 590 in your church Bibles. My people, hear my teaching. Listen to the words of my mouth. I will open my mouth with a parable. I will utter hidden things, things from of old, things we have heard and known, things our ancestors have told us. We will not hide them from their descendants. We will tell the next generation the praiseworthy deeds of the Lord, his power, and the wonders he has done. He decreed statutes for Jacob and established the law in Israel, which he commanded our ancestors to teach their children, so the next generation would know them, even the children yet to be born, and they in turn would tell their children. Then they would put their trust in God and would not forget his deeds, but would keep his commands. They would not be like their ancestors, a stubborn and rebellious generation, whose hearts were not loyal to God, whose spirits were not faithful to him. The men of Ephraim, though armed with bows, turned back on the day of battle. They didn't keep God's covenant and refused to live by his law. They forgot what he had done, the wonders he'd shown them. He did miracles in the sight of their ancestors in the land of Egypt, in the region of Zoan. He divided the sea and led them through. He made the water stand up like a wall. He guided them with the cloud by day and with light from the fire all night. He split the rocks in the wilderness and gave them water as abundant as the seas. He brought streams out of a rocky crag and made water flow down like rivers. But they continued to sin against him, rebelling in the wilderness against the Most High. They willfully put God to the test by demanding the food they craved. They spoke against God. They said, "Can God really spread a table in the wilderness?" True, he struck the rock and water gushed out. Streams flowed abundantly. But can he also give us bread? Can he supply meat for his people? When the Lord heard them, he was furious. His fire broke out against Jacob, and his wrath rose against Israel, for they did not believe in God or trust in his deliverance. Yet he gave a command to the skies above and opened the doors of the heavens. He rained down manna for the people to eat. He gave them the grain of heaven. Human beings ate the bread of angels. He sent them all the food they could eat. He let loose the east wind from the heavens, and by his power made the south wind blow. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
Will you stand, please, for the gradual hymn? It's not another reading. Will you not stand?
Well, you'll be ready when it's time.
Yeah. The Old Testament reading is taken from Exodus, chapter 16, verses 2 to 15, which can be found on page 73 in the Church Bible. In the desert, the whole community grumbled against Moses and Aaron. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the Lord's hand in Egypt. There we sat around pots of meat and ate all the food we wanted, but you have brought us out into this desert to starve this entire assembly to death." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I will rain down bread from heaven for you. The people are to go out each day and gather enough for that day. In this way I will test them and see whether they will follow my instructions. On the sixth day they are to prepare what they bring in, and that is to be twice as much as they gather on the other days." So Moses and Aaron said to all the Israelites, "In the evening you will know that it was the Lord who brought you out of Egypt, and in the morning you will see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard your grumbling against him. Who are we that you should grumble against us?" Moses also said, "You will know that it was the Lord when he gives you meat to eat in the evening and all the bread you want in the morning, because he has heard you grumbling, your grumbling against him. Who are we? You are not grumbling against us, but against the Lord." Then Moses told Aaron, "Say to the entire Israelite community, 'Come before the Lord, for he has heard you, your grumbling.'" While Aaron was speaking to the whole Israelite community, they looked towards the desert, and there was the glory of the Lord appearing in the cloud. The Lord said to Moses, "I have heard the grumbling of the Israelites. Tell them at twilight you will eat meat, and in the morning you will be filled with bread. Then you will know that I am the Lord your God." That evening quail came and covered the camp, and in the morning there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the dew was gone, thin flakes like frost on the ground appeared on the desert floor. And when the Israelites saw it, they said to each other, "What is it?" For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, "It is the bread the Lord has given you to eat." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Okay, for the second time, please stand for the gradual hymn. And the gradual hymn is... Is it Here is Bread?
No, no. Booklet. In the booklet.
In the booklet. I'm doing really number well eight. Today. Upon Him, number 8, please.
Alleluia, alleluia. Speak, Lord, for your servant is listening. You have the words of eternal life.
Alleluia.
Hear the Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to John, page 1070 in the Church Bible.
Glory to you,
O Lord. Once the crowd realized that neither Jesus nor his disciples were there, they got into the boats and went to Capernaum in search of Jesus. When they found him on the other side of the lake, they asked him, "Rabbi, when did you get here?" Jesus answered, "Very truly, I tell you, you are looking for me, not because you saw the signs I performed, but because you ate the loaves and had your fill. Do not work for food that spoils, but for food that endures to eternal life, which the Son of Man will give you. For on him God the Father has placed his seal of approval." Then they asked him, "What must we do to do the works of the works God requires? Jesus answered, "The work of God is this, to believe in the one he has sent." So they asked him, "What sign then will you give that we may see it and believe you?" "What will we do? Our ancestors ate the manna in the wilderness, as it is written, he gave them bread from heaven to eat." Jesus said to them, "Very truly I tell you, it is not Moses who has given you the bread from heaven, but it is my Father who gives you the true bread from heaven. For the bread of God is the bread that comes down from heaven and gives life to the world." "Sir," they said, "always give us this bread." Then Jesus declared, "I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry, and whoever believes in me will never be thirsty." This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for another day in our lives. We thank you for the gift of being here together. Fill us afresh today with your Holy Spirit. Open our hearts and minds to your word so that we won't just be hearers of the word, but through your Holy Spirit we'll be doers of the word. And we ask this all in Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. Well, we have chickens and now we have weed eaters, and this is a part of being in an outdoor service. We have all kinds of things that are competing. But anyway, so glad to have y'all with us. It's good to have some people here visiting. I see we have people on their holidays who've come to join us, and always a pleasure to have new faces in here and children too. So anyway, I wanted to tell you, when I was speaking to children, when I was a child, I had this belief that I was going to be a professional athlete. It started when I watched the movie Chariots of Fire, and I thought I was going to be a professional runner. I remember running through my neighborhood with that song, you all know it, in the back of my head. And I was actually a decent athlete, so, you know, I was, as you know, first, second, third grader, 8, 9, 10, I was like, you know, maybe I have a chance at this. And then it started going into baseball, you know, America, that's a big sport there, and I thought I was going to be a professional baseball player for the Boston Red Sox, which was my dad's team. And then it became soccer, as you all would call football, and I was pretty good at soccer, and I thought, you know what, I have a chance at this. But then, like a lot of Americans, it became American football. And I actually did pretty well. I was on my high school football team, but it came to a point where I realized that I did not have what it took to become a professional athlete of anything, as far as I knew of. I even thought I was pretty good at ping pong until I went to camp, and there was this Chinese girl that was there that was about a foot shorter than me, and she beat me like 21-0, and I thought I was really good. She was amazing, by the way. So, you know, I think all of us grow up as children. We have these ideas and dreams, and some of them do come true, but some of them we realize that we just don't have whatever the ability is, especially when it comes to things like sports, to maybe go on to become a professional when it comes to that. But what do you all believe in? You know, that's one of the reasons we come to church. to talk about our belief in God. You know, in our society, I think that we learn a lot about beliefs. There's a lot of ideas about, you know, just believe in yourself. There's self-help books are all over the place. If you go on the internet, there's this big thing of how you can manifest your own destiny. You know, if you just think the right thoughts, you can become whatever you want to be. And of course, there is some truth to some of that. If you have a positive attitude, if you work out hard, the right mindset, we can accomplish a lot of goals. We know that. And then in the States, and I don't know if that was the same here, there was a whole marketing campaign one Christmas where they had this whole like believe and just believe, these signs you could put in your yard, you'd have reindeers and snowmen and Santa Claus and all that stuff, and just believe, but eventually the holiday would be over and all that stuff would go back up in the attic. You know, with all the uncertainty in the world, I think even when it comes to our religious beliefs sometimes, you know, if I ask you like how important it is in your life, I think most of you, if you were talking to the priest, would say, oh, it's super important. But how does it work out for you on that Monday through Saturday, day-to-day life? Is it something you think about? Is something that makes a difference in your life? Well, regardless if your answer is yes or no, whatever your answer might be, the good news is the kind of belief taught and demonstrated in the Bible is way beyond having the right mindset or trying to manifest something in your life. It is way beyond the nostalgic belief that ends up going up in the attic. And it even is beyond a set of religious beliefs or mantras. If we just say the right things, then good things will happen to us. The type of faith in the Bible requires much, much more, but it is way worth it. It is not easy. It requires all of us, 100% reliance, our lives aligned with God. And it's bigger than us. And I know that sounds like bad news. You're like, well, how are we going to accomplish that? Well, we're going to learn about that today. We're going to be reminded about that today. You see, when we live into this kind of belief, our belief becomes, our lives become bigger and not smaller. When we live in this belief, we are not disappointed. So let's begin by looking at the Hebrew scriptures, the Old Testament. We had two readings. I told Jane like Wednesday, I need you to add a psalm to the reading because it went along with the Old Testament reading. But these readings that we read today in the Hebrew scriptures give us a much more robust idea of what belief actually is. You see, in the Old Testament, belief was not just a mindset saying, I believe something. It was a reliance and it brought forth action. We go back to Abraham, how he believed God and it was counted to him as righteousness. He was given the task by God to go sacrifice his child and he was like, what? But he did it. He went up to the mountain, he put the wood, and his son's like, what's going on? And he goes, don't worry, God will provide. And God did provide. God provided a ram, and God showed Abraham right there that he was not like all the other gods, the false gods that were being worshipped there that did require child sacrifices. This was a God who valued human beings because he created them. He knew them. He was a different God. He was the real God, the true God. See, Abraham demonstrated belief by obedience, by trusting God, even when it didn't make sense. And then in the book of Jonah, when Jonah reluctantly preached the Ninevites, whose lives were a mess, full of chaos, he was hoping they wouldn't repent, and then they did repent. And it says this, that they believed his words were God's words, and they acted. A fast was proclaimed, and all of them, from the greatest to the least, put on sackcloth. They put on like their death clothes, their repentance clothes. They did exactly what Jonah said and they were saved. Belief once again encompassed actions. It wasn't just saying, oh yeah, I believe that, then go do whatever you want to do. It was like, no, we believe, Jonah, that your God is the true God, that our lives are a mess, that we need help, and they acted upon it. We also see many examples in the Old Testament on weak faith, which always correlates with a wrong understanding of God. From our reading today, the Israelites could only focus on the immediate. In spite of the miraculous things God had done when he had led them out of Egypt from their slavery, he had parted the Red Sea, the plagues that came before that, the Passover, he brings them out in the desert, he provides bread from heaven, pheasants for meat for them. Later, Moses would hit a rock and water would come out of it. Time and time again, God was saying, look, I love you. I'm real. And yet they would still grumble. The problem was they were so focused on the gifts, they were missing out on the gift giver. They said these words to Moses when they were hungry. If only we had died by the Lord's hand in Egypt. There we sat around with pots of meat and ate all the food we wanted. But you have brought us into the desert to starve this entire assembly to death. You would think when they saw the whole Red Sea parted, they saw all these miracles happening, that they would say, wait, maybe God can bring us food and water. See, they were short-sighted. They did not see the big picture about what God was doing. They were rebellious. They grumbled against God. They rebelled against his leaders. And scriptures tell they did not keep God's covenant and refused to live by his law. They thought their way was better. They liked complaining. They said, you know what? It was easier being a slave. We got our meals every day. We knew what every day would bring. We didn't really have to rely on God. We just kind of did our thing. They did not believe in God, and they did not trust in his deliverance. But in spite of this, in spite of their grumbling, God continued to provide for his people. In our reading from Exodus today, as I said earlier, he provided bread from heaven. He provided the pheasants for meat. And later, as I told you before, water from a rock. God was patient because, not because they grumbled, because the desert was their testing ground for them to develop a true faith, not just one about getting stuff, right? Not just that vending machine saying, I want a good life, and I would like to have good things happen to me, good friends, good career. No, he wanted them to trust in him, to trust in his love for them. And it would take them a long time. As a matter of fact, they wouldn't even get to the promised land, but the next generation would, because they would pass on all their mistakes they made and what they were learning about God to the next generation who would make it to the promised land. In Psalm 78, which Jane read, it provides us again several things I want us to listen to today about what brings us the kind of belief that the Bible is talking about. The first is a belief that is true, hears and listens to God's word. It says in the psalm, my people hear my teaching and listen to the words of my mouth. Sometimes my wife's talking to me and she's like, are you listening to you? And I'll be like, oh yeah, yeah. And she goes, what did I just say? And I have no idea, right? Because I'm spacing out. But God calls us, the kind of belief he's calling to us, to hear his words and to listen to them and obey them. The other thing he calls us to do is not just obey him, but to share them with others, to share to the next generation. In spite of all the mistakes they made, they did share it with the next generation. It says in the psalm, we will not hide from them their descendants. We will teach the next generation the praiseworthy deeds of the Lord, his power and the wonders he has done. So they pass on their belief to the next generation. The other one is obedience. It's that they would put their trust in God and would not forget his deeds and would keep his commands. It's one thing to know God's words, to memorize words. It's another thing to carry them out. And that's what belief is about. It's not just the mindset. It's not just knowing, but it's carrying it out. And then finally, the next generation would not fall into the bad patterns of the first. They would learn from the mistakes of their parents and their grandparents. You know, so often today we get stuck in, and not by our own fault, but from patterns from our grandparents and our parents that are passed down. But through God's help, we can find healing through that. It says this, they would not be like their ancestors, a stubborn and rebellious generations, whose hearts were not loyal to God, whose spirits were not faithful to him. Belief that is surrendered to God looks for God for healing from those past generations that did not do the right thing. In the New Testament, belief becomes very personal as God incarnate in Christ lives among people like you and me. And rather than God being in a cloud or in a tabernacle, God was in a person, Jesus Christ. Through the life, death, and resurrection, we see belief embodied in Jesus. In Mark's gospel, it says, the time has come, Jesus said, the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe the good news. Belief is about turning our lives around and trusting in the good news. And the good news is not a list. It was Jesus was the good news. Later it says this, yet to all who received and believed in his name, becomes children of God. Belief in Christ changes your status from outsiders to insiders. That famous verse in John 3:16, so all who believed in him shall not perish but have eternal life, it gives us a secure future. And in John 20 it says, but these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. Not just a secure future, but a secure present. Believing in Jesus every day. And when you have this kind of belief, you no longer have this limiting view. When you're faced incredible challenges, everything is possible for the one who believes. God can help us through situations that seem completely impossible. Our own church at Christ the King has seen God answer many prayers, from health crisis to other goals that we've had, where God has done things that church never thought was possible. When our lives are aligned with Christ, when we have that kind of belief in him, God can do amazing things with us and through us and among us. The disciples would carry the same belief into the early church. It says the Lord's hand was with them and a great number of people believed and turned to the Lord. Belief in Christ aligns you with Christ so that you can behave like Christ. See, when we give our lives to Christ, he fills us with the Holy Spirit and gives us the ability to live out this kind of belief in the world. Belief is never left hanging on its own. It's not something you pick up at a yard and you put in the closet. It's not something you just memorize and forget about a few years later. Belief is trusting in Christ, aligning our lives with him, and having the living God, the presence of the Holy Spirit, living in your life. That's the kind of belief we're called to. In our gospel passage today, Jesus calls people to this exact kind of belief. He said, the work of God is this, to believe in the one who sent. He has sent. He was calling people to something much more than just getting some free bread and fish multiplied. He was calling them to put their trust in the gift giver once again. And that's a big task, because that means you're not in control anymore. That means God is on the throne in your life. Christ is on the throne, and that's not easy. That's why so many people would walk away from Jesus. Right at the end of the chapter, it tells that a lot of people walked away because they could not do this teaching. But Jesus declared, I am the bread of life. Whoever comes to me will never go hungry. Whoever believes in me will never be thirsty. He used this metaphor to say we go after so many things in life that don't last. Those decorations that go back in the attic. The clothes that we think are so amazing, and 2 years later we're giving them to a thrift shop because they're no longer in style. The money that we're like, if I just had more money, I could do this or that. And then we end up having to spend the money on a health issue because we can't buy that car we want. None of those things last. All those things are temporary. But Jesus Christ is calling us into a relationship with him that will last us through eternity. Eugene Peterson in the Message version writes this, the person who aligns with me hungers no more and thirsts no more. Goes on to say, every person that the Father gives me eventually comes running to me. And once that person is with me, I hold on and I don't let go. Jesus' grip is secure in your life, in spite of us. You see, Jesus Christ is not, as Earl Palmer, the theologian wrote, the cake of life, a luxury for religious people who like to dabble in religion. Jesus is the barley bread, the poor people's bread. We cannot survive without him. Just as relying on God was fundamental to the people's survival in the desert, for us to live a life that thrives in the present and to have a secure future, our lives need to be aligned with Christ. So I'm going to give you three examples right now. A postage stamp, a ball, and a flock of seagulls, okay? Not the band from the 80s, if anybody knows who that is, okay? So how do we live into this kind of belief? Let me tell you the way we don't live in this belief. Years ago, I went to a youth camp, and there was a lot of wealthier kids who would come from some of the suburbs. And it was interesting, because we noticed a lot of the wealthy kids, they came with their parents' money, so they go to the camp store and they just buy everything up, right? Where the kids that came from, you know, some of the more modest backgrounds were always counting their money and very careful on what they bought, because they had limited resources. And I saw this one girl who was sitting on the floor with a friend, and she was putting postage stamps all over her friend and all over, and they were like 50 cents each. And they were just stuck all over the place, not to be used for a letter. And I was like, her parents bought her those postage stamps And she doesn't appreciate it. She's just using them as art to put on. I don't think that was worth the $12 that she was putting all over herself in postage stamps. But I use that example is sometimes we don't understand that Christ died for us. He sacrificed his life for us so that we could have life. And oftentimes, like that postage stamp teenager who wasn't really thinking at the time, don't want to be too hard on her, we don't think about our faith. We don't think about our beliefs. It just becomes another thing we believe in. So with that said, I want to give you another example. And these are two positive ones. The first is this ball right here. And this ball is your life, okay? Everybody got it? And so oftentimes, we hold on to our life and we distort it so it no longer looks like a ball anymore. But what Christ is saying is like, let me have a grip on your life. Release your grip. And when we release our grip, our lives are no longer distorted, but they come in the shape that God wants. We need to trust God with his grip on our lives and quit trying to distort it and say, no, I want control of everything. When we do that, it goes back into shape. So that's the other example. And the third example, I know you guys are not from the States, but I want to picture you guys one day, you're walking on a beach in Florida. There's just a few people left on the beach. And you notice the sun is setting, everything's beautiful. But there's this old man who's kind of hunched over and he's walking with a bucket. You look up and he carries the bucket up to a pier. This is a true story, by the way, okay? A dock that goes out into the water. He walks over the dock. He stands on the dock. And you notice he is looking up into the sky. And all of a sudden you see a mass of dancing dots. You soon recognize they are seagulls. They're coming out of nowhere. The man takes out his bucket, hands full of shrimp, and begins to throw them out on the dock. The seagulls come and land all around him. Some land on his shoulders, some land on his hat, and they eat the shrimp. Long after the shrimp are gone, his feathered friends linger, just the old man and his birds. What is going on here? Why is this man feeding seagulls? What could compel him? And he does this week after week. Every week he comes. The man in the scene was Eddie Rickenbacker, a famous World War II pilot. His plane, the Flying Fortress, went down in 1942, and no one thought he'd be rescued. Maybe you've heard about him. He and eight passengers escaped death by climbing into two makeshift rafts for 30 days. They fought thirst, the sun, and sharks. The sum of the sharks were 9 feet long, longer than their makeshift rafts. But what nearly killed them was starvation. The rations were gone. Within 8 days, they didn't have anything left. Rickenbacker wrote that even on the rafts, every day they would have a daily afternoon devotional, thanking God for the day in spite of their circumstances. One day after his devotional, Rickenbacker leaned back and put his hat over his head and tried to get some sleep. Within a few moments, he felt something on his head. He knew in an instant that it was a seagull which had perched on his raft, but he knew that there were hundreds of miles out of sea. Where did the seagull come from? He was also certain that if he didn't get that seagull, he would die. Soon, all the others on the two boats noticed the seagull. No one spoke, no one moved. Rickenbacker quickly grabbed the seagull, and with thanksgiving, they ate the flesh of the bird. They used the intestines for fish bait and survived. Rickenbacker never forgot that visitor who came from a foreign place. That sacrificial guest, every week he went on the pier with a bucket of shrimp and said, thank you, thank you, thank you. The postage stamps, that's like, no thank you. The ball, the grip that says, God, I trust your grip more than mine. And the seagulls of thank you, thank you, that you love me, that you created me, that you know me, that you died for me on the cross. That's the kind of belief that we're called to. It's when we're belief, faith, obedience, all of it's wrapped up. That as we move through life, we move with gratitude, just like the man with the seagulls. We trust God's grip, and we try the best we can not to be like the post stamps, where we're just not thinking about God as we go through our day-to-day life. Let me pray for us. Lord God, belief is no easy matter. It's one thing to say we believe, it's another thing to live it out. But this is much bigger than us. But we thank you that you are more than willing to help, that we can trust your grip to reshape us, to reform us, to do your will. Lord, that we can, with gratitude, come here each week and say thank you, thank you, thank you. And on that Monday through Friday or Saturday, as we live our lives out there in the world, we could live a life of belief where others can see us and see you because of your Spirit that lives in us. Lord, help us again by the power of the Holy Spirit to live into that kind of belief. And we ask this all in Jesus' name, amen.
Will you please stand? And let us affirm our faith by saying together the Nicene Creed on page 5. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Please sit, and Sue will lead us in our intercessions.
Let us pray. Everlasting God, we bring our prayers of intercession to you, Lord of all nations, asking that your blessings of love and peace may be known to all people everywhere. Help us to grow abundant fruit from the seeds of potential that you have planted within us. Help us to be bringers and doers of the message of love and hope that we have in the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. We pray that you will bring forward Spirit-filled church leaders worldwide to help spread the message of God's redeeming love. In the Anglican cycle of prayer, we pray for the Anglican Church in Kenya. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Everlasting God, hear us now as we pray. We pray for those struggling to find enough to eat because of drought and famine, war and unrest. Give strength to the agencies that continue to supply aid to those in need. We pray for countries suffering under oppressive regimes, where freedom to speak against the wrong done by those in authority is not allowed. Fill the hearts of world, national and local leaders with compassion and wisdom for the people they serve. Help all those who have plenty to share generously with those who have very little. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Everlasting God, in this holiday season we pray for areas, of which Portugal is one, where they feel overwhelmed by the influx of visitors. For many of these areas, tourists are a major source of income and provide jobs for many people. We pray that sensible decisions will be made that satisfy the needs of both local people and visitors. And we pray that visitors will respect the areas and the people where they are staying. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of healing and hope, we bring before you now prayers for the sick, for the depressed, for the lonely. We pray for those living with long-term illnesses. Give them and their families the strength to get through each day. We pray for those who have received devastating diagnosis with no obvious solutions, but doctors will find a way to help them. We pray for those with mental health struggles, some that are not always obvious to those around them, that you will give them peace of mind. You are a God who heals, and sometimes it's hard for us to understand when our prayers for healing seem to go unanswered. Help us, Lord, to remember that your healing takes many forms and is done in your time. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for those who have lost a loved one recently. Our thoughts and prayers go out to the families and friends of the three little girls who were killed on Monday in Southport. Every day, families are grieving the loss of someone they knew and loved, whether it be through illness, accident, or mindless violence. We pray that your Holy Spirit will bring comfort to those who are grieving. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
We thank you, Lord, for our Church of Christ the King, and pray that you will be with us all in the coming week in all our activities. Help us to be good witnesses of your love, of the love you have for us and everyone we meet. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Christ is our peace. He has reconciled us to God in one body by the cross. We meet in his name and share his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Also with you.
Let us offer one another a sign of peace. Yeah, let's say it today.
Okay.
Yeah. One less thing.
Yes, thank you.
It's beautiful some Sundays, but it's okay to mix it up. Yes. So.
Keep us on our toes.
Our offertory song is found in your hymnal book, that bigger, thicker book, on page 842, or number 842, sorry, there's not 842 pages in it. Here is Bread is the name of the song. Please stand for our offertory song if you are able.
Eight, four, two.
this and to bring more people to you. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you. Please be seated. On page 7 in your green books, yours, Lord, is the greatness, the power, the glory, the splendor, and the majesty, for everything in heaven and on earth is yours. All things come from you, and of your own do we give you. The Lord is here. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Father, we give you thanks and praise through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your living Word, through whom you have created all things, who was sent by you in your great goodness to be our Savior. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he took flesh as your Son, born of the Blessed Virgin. He lived on earth and went about among us. He opened wide his arms for us on the cross. He put an end to death by dying for us. He revealed the resurrection by rising to new life. So he fulfilled your will and won for you a holy people. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, forever praising you and saying, Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Lord, you are holy indeed, the source of all holiness. Grant that by the power of your Holy Spirit and according to your holy will, these gifts of bread and wine may be for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who in the same night that he was betrayed, he took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Great is the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen, Christ will come again. And so, Father, calling to mind his death on the cross, his perfect sacrifice made once for the sins of the whole world, rejoicing in his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, and looking for his coming in glory, we celebrate this memorial of our redemption. And we offer you this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. We bring before you this bread and this cup, and we thank you for counting us worthy to stand in our presence and serve you, in your presence and serve you. Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one in your kingdom, all who share this one bread and one cup, so that we in the company of all the saints may praise and glorify you forever. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Amen. And as our Savior taught us, so we pray loudly. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Though we are many, we are one body, but we all share in one bread.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world, grant us peace. We do not presume to come to you this table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness. but in your manifold and great mercies, we are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table. But you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your Son, Jesus Christ, to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen. Draw near with faith, receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you, and his blood, which he shed for you. Eat and drink in remembrance that he died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation.
Wow. We always try to keep you guys entertained. Every Sunday's different here at Christ the King. All right. With that being said, we're going to do our post-communion prayer to some background music. So let us pray together. Almighty God, we thank you for feeding us with the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, we offer you our souls and bodies to be a living sacrifice. Send us out in the power of your Spirit to live and work to your praise and glory. Amen.
Over to you, Jane.
Okay, welcome to everybody on Zoom and visitors and returnees. It's so lovely to have some nice, beautiful young families here. I mean, beautiful old families too, but you know, beautiful young families. Thank you to Steve for a lovely service. It's like competition going on there, but we managed. Thank you, Colin, tech team. Music, gorgeous. We had an extra little blessing today. Alison, one of our new girls, I just asked her if she'd like to come back every week. She sings beautifully.
Oh, right.
Thank you, Alison. That was perfect.
You're marked.
You will see on the welcome table this morning there is the water bottles. So you bring your old, your brown coins that you don't, nobody spends them, and they go towards making
clean water
in Africa. And then you take a bottle of clean water away with you. Usual things on this week, on Monday, 5 o'clock, we have prayers on Zoom. Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, branch group. Midweeks, they've changed slightly. So this week we've got midweek service here in Almondsill, not here in Almondsill, not in August. What do I know? And it's not in Tavira either. So midweek services are not on this week. But the Tavira one is on Zoom at 10:30. Is that CTK1? Yes. Okay. So if you normally go to the Tavira one, talk to Joe Blackman. Lovely. And we've got a birthday today. I don't normally do them. I just wanted to say, Sarah, happy birthday, darling. Congratulations. Okay, I'll see you. Thank you.
All right. Happy birthday again to Sarah. Great, all the visitors, as Jane said, who came. Please linger around a little afterwards. Be good to get to know you all. We'll have a little fellowship time here. And if there's people going to a coffee shop, you can just ask them where to go and follow them. Please stand for our closing song, which is found on...
Our closing song, 689. It's one you know really well. So really, really loud.
Sing up.
Please.
Our vision. Remember, and say after me, we are a community in Christ.
We are a community in Christ.
Called to be unified.
Called to be equipped.
So we can be missional. Amen.
Amen.
Thanks, Terry.
I hope
from me said something. Remember, two grips on your life. Yours distorts when you take God out of the equation. Allow God to reshape you, to reform you every day so you don't miss out on all that he has for you in this life and the life to come. That being said, the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen. Amen.